on the platform of Arafat, where the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam repeated what he told the Sahaba before, but in a short form. And he repeated this khutbah on Arafat and on Mina twice to confirm the summary of his teaching to the world for the last 23 years. And he reminded them to make a clear cut between Islam and non-Islam. When he said, إِنَّ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ أَوْ إِنَّ كُلَّ أَمْرٍ مِنْ أُمُورِ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ مَوْضُوعٌ تَحْتَ قَدَمِي هَذَا. Everything to do with the pre-Islamic line is over. Now you are Muslims, and we should cut our ties completely with anything to do with Jahiliyyah. And Jahiliyyah means when we do something, but not the Islamic way. As we know that, there are only two ways to do things in our life, the Islamic way or the non-Islamic way. And the Holy Quran pointed out some of the Jahiliyyah some Muslims are still living in. And we call them Al-Jahiliyyah Al-Arba fil Quran, the four ignorant life system in the Quran. And one of them, أَفَحُكْمَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ يَبْغُونَ, the judgment of the Jahiliyyah, the law of the Jahiliyyah, the ignorance, the non-Islamic one, when many people, if anything happens, they don't want to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about it, what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said about it. They don't go to the Islamic solution of problems. They go to the man-made laws, and they believe in that and forget Islam. Hukm al-Jahiliyyah. But a true believer will never go to God. If anything happens, they will say, this is what happened. I want to know what I need to do and how to face this as a believer. Otherwise, it's the Jahiliyyah system. Another one, Dhan al-Jahiliyyah. The way some people think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If anything happened to them on their way to Allah, they start to have doubt about Allah's support or care. And they bring up questions. How come this happened to me? I have been praying all my life. I have been fasting and so on. So they lose their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through emotion. Because the iman is not there yet. The way we think of him. And another one, Hamiyatul Jahiliyyah, when people support each other because they are brothers, or because they are from the same country, or because they speak the same language. And they will go against somebody else because that person is not from their country. This is Hamiyatul Jahiliyyah. They support each other not for Islam, but for the nationalism and so on. Islam calls that, it is Jahiliyyah. Even if you are educated, but this is how we live our life, it is Jahiliyyah, it is ignorance in Islam. And another one, Tabarruj al-Jahiliyyah. It is when we go out in the wrong way. It can be men or women. Especially going out unnecessarily. وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَا تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ الْأُولَى. When the Holy Quran started with the words of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, don't live like your life before Islam. Outside life, always out. And especially when we go out and we don't dress properly. This is tabarruj. Tabarruj means I'm going out and I did not cover my aura through so many ways. Maybe because my clothes is too tight and people can see the shape of my body, or it is see-through. And this applies to men and women. Sometimes we think hijab is only for the women. And we know the Islamic uniform that Islam revealed for us. And the purpose. How can I know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if I don't know the same thing in my life? How to put my dress on? Ya Bani Adam, qad anzalna ilaykum libasan yuwari sawhatikum wa risha. How can we know Allah if you don't even know the purpose of clothing? The purpose of clothing to a Muslim is that I'm putting this clothes on to cover my aura. This is the first purpose. And number two, to protect myself from the condition of the weather. So this is tabarruk. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam reminded the crowd, because he was telling them indirectly, you may not see me again, you may not hear from me again, so learn properly. So he summarized Islam for them. And some of the Sahaba, they got the message. Mu'adh bin Jabal cried when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was sending him to Yemen, the high part of Yemen. And he sent Abu Musa al-Ash'ari to the other part of Yemen to make da'wah. And he told Mu'adh, while Mu'adh was riding his camel, and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was walking with him on his way to say goodbye to him on his way to Yemen to make da'wah. And he reminded him the rules of making da'wah, or the system of making da'wah. He said to him, Ya Mu'adh, innaka ta'ti qawman ahla kitab. It's very important to know who we are talking to. These people are the people of the book. They have some knowledge about deen, about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but not pure. So call them first of all to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the shahada. Let them know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Once they know him, the true knowledge, they will be ready to listen to him. And once they come to accept the shahada that Allah is one, go to the next one. Remind them about their salat. They need to pray 5 times a day. And if they accept that, go to the next one, the zakat, and so on. And make sure, on the process of the da'wah, don't do anything wrong to anyone of them. Because once you do wrong to them, even you're making da'wah, and they complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will never miss you. It means whatever they ask Allah to do to you, it will happen, because they are victims of you not knowing how to make the da'wah to them. And then he said to Mu'adh in the end, oh Mu'adh, remember, maybe you will come back one day here, but you may not see me, but you will see my grave and my masjid. Then Mu'adh cried. The Prophet alayhi salam said to him, don't cry Mu'adh. Crying is from shaitan, don't cry. Remain strong and firm. This is the nature of our life. So he was indicating sometime to them, his mission is about to be over, and what has been written to him as a human being will come to him one day. Dead. But he reminded them, the people of Hajj, they will come back, and maybe some already did. And what will be their feeling? We can think what their feeling will be, especially this year. 119 people died, and then 717, they will come up with these memories. But they need to remember, as we said last time, people die, Muslims and non-Muslims, good people and bad people, and there does not mean anything except the reality, the thing. Everybody is sure about it. But what matters is how we die. And as we said last time, we should not cry for those people who died in Mecca. They made it. And they could say, Fustu wa Rabbil Kaaba. The same way Hadid, our sister, could say, Fustu wa Rabbil Kaaba. Because they died on their way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The moment of jihad, a mighty struggle to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they will remember death, but how to die. If these people could say, first to Arab in Kaaba, it was the way of death, may someone who killed a Muslim become a Muslim. His name is Jubair ibn Salma. In the battlefield, with his spear, his tail, he ran Ibn Milhan from the back. Until the spear came out from his chest, and the blood was coming out. And he ran Ibn Milhan and said, "Push to Arab bin Kaaba. I won. I got what I wanted. I'm the winner. By the Lord of the Kaaba." And he was holding the blood and wiping his face, happy. But the person who told him could not understand. This is something extraordinary. How come he is happy on this moment? That man has come with a question. A shaheed, someone who has been killed because of their Islam, do they feel the pain of death? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam answered, and he said, "Ma yajidu shahidu min alam al-qatl illa kama yajidu ahadukum alam al-qirsa." The only pain a shaheed will feel from the killing is the amount of pain when you feel if something flicks you, like a needle or a thorn. Normal. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam explained what? How come the shaheed, they don't feel the pain that much? Because of six reasons. The shaheed, six of his soul. Something special only for the shaheed. يغفر له من أول دفعة من دمه. When the shaheed blood comes out for the first time, that shaheed sin will be forgiven completely. This is number one. Forgiven for whatever they have done. Except if they owe somebody some money. Back to the issue of the money. And number two, يرى مقعده من الجنة. When a shaheed dies straight away, they can see their place in paradise. And number three, يؤمن من عذاب القبر. They have no issues at all inside the grave. No punishment, no worries for them in the grave. And number four, يؤمن من الفزع الأكبر. On the day of judgment, when men can come out of their grave, frightened, scared, panicked, worried, a shaheed will not be like that. They will be safe and in tranquility. Just like someone who died during the Hajj. They will come up and say, "Labbaik Allahumma labbaik." They are still on the call. And number four, يُحَلَّى بِحُلْيَةِ الْإِيمَانِ. A shaheed will be dressing the clothes of faith. Special clothes for the people of Iman. And number five, يُزَوَّجُ مِنَ الْقُولِ الْعَيْنِ. They will get the best partnership or husband or wife in paradise. Part of our strength in our life is when we have a husband who we can trust and live and die for, or when we have a wife who we can trust and live and die for. This is part of our strength in our social life. We can mistrust the entire world, but once you have someone living with you, sharing you like everything with trust, you feel strong. A shaheed will get that also, even after death in paradise. And number six, they can give shafa'ah to 70 people from their relatives. 70 people from their relatives will be in trouble on the day of judgment, and the shaheed can say to Allah, "Oh Allah, for me, let this person go." And Allah will respect their wish on that day. This is only for the shaheed. But when people are immoral, when people's conscience is dirty and unclean, they will forget all of this fight and they will say, you know what? Why is the Muslims fight for jihad? Because they want to die and go to paradise to get women and get wives. Only low moral people who have a nasty or dirty thought about men and men relation, they straight away go to that point. And they spread around the world, the Muslims are dying because they want to get married. This is how they take it. And they forgot our strength in this life is in our husband or in our wife. The rest of the world are people only who can make comments about us. Nothing else. So we should not cry, for this being the number of people who are in Mecca, we cry because we couldn't make it like that. What is better than dying during the Salah? What is better than dying during Hajj? What is better than dying in your niqab? They can say anything to excuse themselves. They can say, we are shooting the Palestinian children because they have rocks. They can hurt us. And they're using their guns to shoot these things. They can say, we shot Hadid because she was having a knife, a weapon of mass destruction. The same thing the Iraqi people had to be bombed by America because of this weapon. Maybe Hadid was having it under his clothes now. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her the shahada. And she will say in her heart, "Fuz to Rabbil Ka'bah." And what they have done to her body after that is a stain of shame on the face of humanity. Who are crying for animals mistreatment around the world, but they don't cry for a human being. Not an ordinary human being. Those women who represent the wives of the prophets, all of the prophets. Those people who have no fear of bullets, but they are afraid to let any sinful eye see their body. Hadid made it. Will we make it or will we give up? So when we talk about people coming back from Hajj, others are landing on the field of the Shahada. And the land of Palestine, every single day, drinking from the innocent blood. And it will come up one day. That is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is up to anybody in this dunya. Kill as many as you want. It will come back. And the heavier thing to take back to Allah is when you go back with somebody's blood in your neck. The world has been unfair to them, but justice is the nature of this life. It will take anybody, a believer or a non-believer. When we do injustice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be our opponent. You are fighting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will see how long we can last. So the people of Hajj are coming back after drinking from the water of Shifa, the water of healing, which gave healing to Laila from Morocco, which gave healing to many people. And many people after their comeback, they will say, I just finished the course of Hajj in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not keep me in Mecca. The way he kept more than 700 people, but he sent me back home to see what I will do after Hajj and how I will live my life. The Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam used every step on Arafat and Mina to give life to the believers who are there. Even when he was making the dua, famous dua, dua of Arafat, in which part of it he said, Allahumma innaka tasma'u kalami. Oh Allah, you are hearing my words, the language of my heart, the voice that nobody else can hear except you, which I'm saying on the platform of Arafat. Wa tara makani. Oh Allah, you know where I am. I'm on Arafat. وَتَعْلَمُ سِرِّي وَعَلَنِيَّتِي. Oh Allah, you know me inside out. You know what I say and what I don't say. You know what I do and what I don't do. تعلم كل شيء عن نفسي. You know everything about me. أنا البائس, أنا الفقير, أنا المستغيث, أنا المستجير. Oh Allah, I am the miserable one. I am the poor. I am the one who is seeking for your help and your protection. He says this dua on Arafat. And when he was saying that, he wanted the Muslims to learn how to talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala silently. And he kept on going in his dua. As'aluka mas'alatan miskin wa abtahilu ilayka ibtihal al-mudhnib al-dhalil wa ad'uka dua al-khaif al-dharir. Oh Allah, I'm asking you the way the needy people do. I'm asking you the way those people who are extremely in need, their heart will talk to Allah and their soul will be connected to Him before their mouth speak. And I'm supplicating to you and making dua the way someone who feels guilty and feels sinful, the way they do it in order to clean their sins. And I'm making dua to you just like someone who is weak and blind in a dangerous land, a non-safe land. Only Allah can save that person who has given this dua. And then he says, Rabbi, la taj'alni bidu'aika Rabbi shaqiyya. Oh Allah, with this dua, I don't want you to make me a miserable person in my life. Kun bi ra'ufan rahima. Be to me pardoning and merciful. And who was saying this dua? It is someone whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called bil mu'minina ra'ufur rahim. Oh Muhammad, you are very passionate, very pardoning and kind to the believers. And he's giving this sifat back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the place of Arafat. And after reminding the people on Arafat, also on the way back again, he noticed some disagreement between Ali ibn Abi Talib, karramallahu wajha, and some of the Sahara. And he reminded them again on his way back to Medina, in a place near to Jufa. And Jufa is the miqat for the people who are coming from Sham, from Syria, Lebanon, to go to Hajj. They have to enter the haram from Jufa. Someone goes to that place called Rabir Ham. And when he notices a bit of dispute between Ali ibn Abi Talib, karramallahu wajha, and some of the Sahaba, and he reminded them again, all Muslims, I'm a human being, and the call of Allah may come to me one day, and I will say yes, and I will go. I'm leaving with you, tekalain or takalain, two big responsibilities. First of all, it is to do with your Islam. The book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fihi al-huda wal-nur, fastamsiku bi kitabillah. Hold on very tight to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you hold on to the Quran, you will never be misguided. But if you put it behind you, you will lead a life in which you will lose. This is number one. Hold on to the Quran and to the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salam. And number two, wa ahla bayti. Udhakirukum Allah fi ahli bayti. And he said it three times. I'm reminding you, take care of my family. I'm reminding you, take care of my family. Three times. And then he called Ali, especially Ali ibn Abi Talib. Allahumma wali man wala. وعاد من عادا من كنت وليا فعلي وليا. If I mean anything to you, Ali had to mean to you too. If you love me, you have to love Ali. And he reminded them to remember who is this man, Ali bin Abi Talib. He is one of the three people who stood up for Islam when there was no one. People later came into Islam to enjoy Islam. When this great king fought for it very hard, Abu Bakr Siddiq as a man, Khadija as a woman, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. And the dispute was, some people were given some of the things. Ali ibn Abi Talib took it back because this is the money from the homes from the Baitul Mal. So he took it, was right. Then they start to complain. So the Prophet alayhi wasallam reminded them, you have to know who this man is. He was there for Islam when nobody was. Don't complain, and whatever he did was right. He took it back from you, it was right. And this is how he came to remind the Sahaba who Ali ibn Abi Talib was. The way he reminded them who Abu Dharr was, who Umar ibn Khattab was, Abu Bakr was, and so on. The way he reminded Khalid ibn Walid when he had a dispute with Abdurrahman ibn Awf. La tasubbu ashabi. Do not say anything bad about my Sahaba. He was talking about the early Sahaba, who came into Islam early, when it was very hard to be a Muslim. And he said to the late Sahaba, if you spend everything you could, if you have this world full of gold, and you spend it in the cause of Allah, not equal to a handful of gold they spent. So we have to know who are these people. And when he came close to Medina, Zul-Hulaifa, before he spent the night in Zul-Hulaifa, where the people of Medina put their ihram on. And later he left Zul-Hulaifa to go to Medina, and when he saw Medina, he said, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah. Lahu al-mulku wa lahu al-hamdu yuhyi wa yumeet. Wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadeer. آيبون تائبون عابدون ساجدون لربنا حامدون. We are coming back home. We are doing tawbah. We worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We prostrate going to sujood. We will be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And on his way to Medina, what happened after that, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala extend our life till next Friday, we will continue inshallah. While you are praying for those people who died, we pray for the people who are alive and sick and dying. Our brother right now, Iftikhar Salahuddin, in the hospital in a very critical condition. We pray for him the best in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma qfil lil muslimina wal muslimat. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على هذا النبي الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم أحسن ختامنا وأخرجنا من الدنيا مسلمين. ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان. اللهم انتصر للمستضعفين في كل مكان وعليك بالتقاة الظالمين فإنهم لا يجزون حياة يأخذون. عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. وآمين. السلام عليكم.